Welcome to another online conversation series at United Nations University. I'm Sabine Becker-Thierry, and today I have the pleasure of introducing Professor Marie Lall to you all. She's a professor of education and South Asian studies at the University College London and a South Asia expert in politics and education. Her latest book appeared just a few months ago. It's entitled Myanmar's Education Reforms, A Pathway to Social Justice. It's published by UCL Press. Thank you all for watching tonight, and we also hope that participants in Myanmar are able to follow this event. We will discuss with Marie for about 15, 20 minutes, and then turn to you for questions. So please type your questions into the chat box at any time, and we'll do our best to pick it up during Q&A. Marie, the military seized power on 1st of February. In Myanmar, and the day the newly elected parliamentarians were expected to take their seats. For many of us watching from afar, it was a shocking backslide for a country that was taking steps towards democracy. We also know there have been allegations of fraud, but was that coup by the military necessary?
No, actually, in my view personally, I don't think it was necessary. And the reason for that is that this is all about the 2008 constitution. The entire thing goes back to that one document. And the 2008 constitution, just very briefly, for those of you who might not know about this, is part of a seven-step roadmap that was started by Kinyunt, General Kinyunt, who was part of the original junta in around 2003-2004. And the idea of creating this constitution was it as a pathway towards a disciplined, quote unquote, democracy. And in that constitution, the military reserves 25% of all seats in all parliaments, that means upper house, lower house, regions and states, for the military. And it keeps three key ministries, home ministry, border affairs and military affairs. And what that means is that in effect, the military had power. And we have to understand that the military, the Tatmadaw, is the glue of the nation. It sees itself as the glue of the nation, and it's very much perceived by a lot of people as the stalwart to keep Myanmar together. And with that, they have kept a central part of Myanmar politics in their control. And we had obviously the elections in 2010, which brought in the first civilianized government under President Thein Sein, which started the reform process, but the military was very much a part of it. And then we had the elections in 2015 and the NLD won. But a very key thing happened at that point when Aung San Suu Kyi won the elections. She went to Senior General Tan Shui and effectively got his blessings in quotation marks. There was a conversation, which is private, which happened at that point in time where there was an agreement that she would lead the nation with her democratically elected NLD party. And then we had the elections in 2020. And as you said correctly, there were allegations of fraud. The USDP party, which is the party that was in power between 2011 and 2015, did very badly. It did not get the kind of seats that it was expecting. They brought allegations of fraud. And the first thing the Tatmadaw did, I was very proud of the Tatmadaw at that point, they said it's the election commission's issue. And the election commission then was tasked to investigate. When they did not, or when they said this, there was no fraud, the Tatmadaw went to the parliament and the parliament said, we're busy with something else. And then they asked for the National Defense and Security Council to sit where they have a majority because they expected at that point to delay the start of parliament until these fraud allegations had been investigated. Now, the thing is, the fraud allegations are, there are issues with the voter list, but the fraud allegations are a smokescreen for bigger issues. Now, we are basically, it was not a necessary coup, but it clearly there was something going on that the Tatmadaw was unhappy with. And since they're so central to Myanmar politics, they saw this as the only way to reestablish control.
So in other words, the NLD or Aung San Suu Kyi did not violate the constitution at all.
As far as we can see, there's the Tatmadaw is arguing that the constitution is not being followed. The NLD and Aung San Suu Kyi will argue that they are following the constitution. This 2008 constitution was accepted by the NLD and by the wider electorate, even though it means that there was a kind of power sharing arrangement where the Tatmadaw was dealing with its things and the NLD or the government was dealing with the reform processes. But the issue here is between basically the government wanting to sit because it had won the elections with 83% of the vote, and the Tatmadaw feeling that it was being sidelined in terms of its central position, it was no longer the kind of original power sharing agreement. Their views were not being taken into account in the way that they would have expected. Aung San Suu Kyi's relationship with General Min Aung Hlaing, the chief of staff, have been deteriorating. They apparently haven't met for over a year. My understanding is from speaking to people in the country that there were negotiations in the days prior to the coup, and that the Tatmadaw was willing to have a kind of compromise solution. The NLD and Aung San Suu Kyi in particular are not known to go for compromise solutions. Perhaps a discussion at that point on how to go forward would have been necessary, sort of very much in the light that the way that Aung San Suu Kyi had met Tan Shui before taking power in 2015, that might have brought a different outcome. But given that there was this power sort of powering through, we will just continue on the, because we are right, that didn't go down well. That's where I see is the main problem between the Tatmadaw and the NLD. And I think the coup happened because General Min Aung Hlaing felt that if he didn't do it now, there was no other way of doing it later because he's due to retire in 6 months' time.
So now Aung San Suu Kyi is back under house arrest, deja vu. We have mass protests on the streets, deja vu in 88, another year since then. But what is different with these mass protests today? What information do you have from Yangon, from Naypyidaw?
Well, first of all, the protests are, the origin of the protests is quite different. If you look back to 88, and even if you go back to 2007, I'm taking 1990 out of the equation at the moment, but 88 and 2007, these always started as economic protests, which then morphed into pro-democracy protests. This one is very clearly one which is directly linked to what people perceive, young people perceive as the elections having been stolen from them. And they are very large, much larger than 2007, and they're countrywide, and different ethnic groups are following into that as well. So you have protests in all parts of the country. I mean, I've had friends of mine from Michina who've been talking about the protests in Kachin State, and I've got friends in Shan State who've also been saying that.
Far away from the capital, yeah.
And obviously there's what's going on in the capital, but you have four main groups. So you have the press seems to be calling Generation Z, and they are the ones who are, they even have a sense of humor when they're going out in sort of costumes and ball gowns and all the rest of it. They also seem to be rather rude vis-a-vis the military, which is again, very interesting because you normally don't speak to the military in these kind of words and tones. You have the 88 generation, which has tried in many ways to take a bit of a leading role, but they've been sort of slightly sidelined in this. The NLD, many people obviously who've been arrested from the NLD, but those who have not have been protesting as well. And most importantly and most interestingly is how the civil servants have reacted. So the civil disobedience movement, I understand from 88, from friends of mine who went through 88, that civil servants also protested, but when they were threatened with losing their jobs, many of them went back. Here it's a bit different because the capital is obviously separate in Naypyidaw. And so the protests in Naypyidaw are of a different kind of nature then because it's not joining in together with the ordinary people. So the civil disobedience movement is complementary in many ways. The idea seems to be to lay the country still. Yesterday and the day before we saw the car breakdown story where people parked their cars, put their bonnets up and couldn't be moved in order to not allow for police vans to be able to go through the streets in Yangon. So the protests are different from the previous times.
If we take a step back at the last 10 years, if not more, often referred to as a decade of reform under NLD, Aung San Suu Kyi, a lot of movement has come into economics, into the peace process, but there also has been a lot of frustration among the population. What What is your understanding, and how does this influence also currently the protests and the expectations?
So the decade of reforms falls into two parts. It falls into 2011 to 2015 under President Hussein, when really I would argue, and my books have argued, that really the large part of the reforms were taken forward in that period. Partly a lot of low-hanging fruit could be picked, which is great, but a lot of the movement forward. President Hussein came on the radio and said that he had three particular priorities. The first one was national reconciliation with the NLD, the second one was ethnic peace, and the third one was economic reform, and then later on he came up with a fourth, which was education reform. A lot of the big heavy lifting was done at that particular point in time. Without that, the NLD would have never been able to come into power. The NLD inherited an incomplete reform process and continued, but actually re-centralized a lot of the power that had been sort of let down towards civil society and other organizations under President Hussein. And the last 5 years, particularly, I work in education, I've worked with the Ministry of Education, and I've been seeing the ministry under three, under the generals, under President Hussein, and under Aung San Suu Kyi. And really, the ministry, under Hussein, ministry under the NLD, was able to, it was very difficult for them to do things. They had a huge program. They were trying to do too much at the same time, and the bureaucracy and the hierarchies were really stalling a lot of the reforms. My understanding is that it was very similar for the economic reforms. Things were much slower. People were getting a bit irritated. That doesn't mean that the NLD wasn't extremely popular. We saw that in the vote. People would support Aung San Suu Kyi for the sacrifices she has made, and the alternative being a military-supported government is not what they wanted. But that doesn't mean that everyone was happy, and the peace process fell aside totally. I mean, it's just totally fallen apart, which is why actually the Tatmadaw now under Min Aung Hlaing has said, we will take over the peace process again and we will bring things forward. But in that, I just have to add, at the same time as the coup has happened, there has been further breaking of the national ceasefire agreement, nationwide ceasefire agreement, mainly in Karen state, but also in Southern Shan state. So in how far there will actually be movement once the dust has settled, in terms of continuing on that peace process that was started under President Hussein, we will just have to wait and see.
Maybe one last question from me before I look at the questions that are trickling in, and please continue sending in your questions from the audience. Can you briefly talk also about Aung San Suu Kyi as a leader in Myanmar? There seems to be quite a different picture of her in the international community or outside of Myanmar compared to inside Myanmar, where she is seen still as the leader, whereas outside, ever since she received the Nobel Peace Prize, the situation, the tide has turned.
So Aung San Suu Kyi obviously had a very was in a very difficult position once she stepped out of house arrest. It's always easy to idealize people who are in jail or under house arrest and where they can't speak and you don't know what they're thinking. And in many ways, I think the West looked at her as this icon, this pro-democracy icon, who with her peaceful resistance, just by remaining under house arrest and refusing to leave the country, because there was an offer for her to leave, and just staying there and just waiting out the time for the country. And then she steps out and she becomes a real live politician with opinions which don't necessarily match quite the way that the West had made it up to be. So there's that gap, and that gap obviously came out particularly with the issue of the Muslims in Northern Rakhine, when we had the issue there where I think it was in 2017, it was between 600,000 and 700,000 refugees into Bangladesh. And obviously Aung San Suu Kyi didn't speak against what was going on there. She just said, we need to investigate and there are terror attacks. And then she went to the International Court of Justice at The Hague to defend her government, not necessarily only the Tatmadaw, but her government, which was part of that, to say that there was no genocide. And that's when the West sort of lost faith in her in many ways. However, on the contrary, in Myanmar, this had the exact opposite effect, if anything. The fact that people were upset about the economy not growing the way they had expected and social justice issues not being addressed, the fact that she stood up to what was seen as the West and the outside bullying world didn't understand the problems that Myanmar is going through, made her more popular. So when in Oxford, her portrait was taken down in that one college where she's been very close to her entire life. Actually, there were young people in the streets demonstrating with her portrait saying, they take your portrait down, we put your portrait up. So she was seen very much as, so all the sort of more economic reform mistakes paled away in light of her standing up to everyone. And in many ways, people saw this also as having to work together with the Tatmadaw. That was part of the compromises, quote unquote. She was not very good at compromises normally, but in that sense, the power sharing agreement, she had to basically say, okay, this is something they're doing, and nothing I can do about it. I disagree with that slightly. I just want to say that had she would have been able to do not something about the violence, but she could have let United Nations and other agencies in to support the refugee population. And that was in her gift. And I think a lot of people don't realize that perhaps in her personally, when she looks at her largely Burma Buddhist support base, that she herself perhaps believes that, but definitely she would feel weakened if she took the side of minorities, especially Muslim minorities. So it's a very complex issue to try and summarize in what is 10 seconds, but I hope that sort of makes sense.
Absolutely. I'd only add that the special rapporteur for the Secretary General, who's in Myanmar, also, of course, is regularly reporting and is quite concerned actually right now about what could happen any time. We know that not only recently, also in previous uprisings, there have been shootings, there could be, the situation could easily escalate. For now, it has not been the case. I will look at questions now, Marie, if you bear with me. Hannah Traven from Keio University is asking, do you think social media has influenced how these protests have played out? For example, do the election fraud allegations come from proliferation of fake news on social media? How will this affect future elections?
So social media has been the one thing which has fueled absolutely everything in Myanmar. It's like since the advent of the internet and mobile phones, actually people don't even realize that it's the internet. Most of what happens is on Facebook. People get their news from Facebook. People communicate on Facebook. And Facebook has been known as a medium of propagating both fake news and as a medium of propagating, actually getting people together to do things, like, for example, in this protest. That's one of the reasons why Facebook was shut down. But in many ways, there has been an issue with fake news or Facebook being used for fake news. This also happened in 2017 when we had the anti-Muslim protests with people being accused of rape and arson and entire neighborhoods converging on one particular house. So Facebook is known to have propagated fake news across the country. And that has been a big issue. Now, with regards to the fraud allegations, the fact is that, let's be very clear, there are big issues with the voter lists, but that doesn't mean that there has been fraud. In fact, it's very unlikely that there's been any fraud. And there were enough people who watched these elections and could check them. And it's virtually impossible, even if you're registered in multiple places, to go to be able to vote in multiple places. Simply the logistics are perfectly impossible. But obviously, Facebook and social media was used to propagate that in certain quarters. And it was also used on the other side to propagate the counter allegations. So in many ways, it's, yeah, social media is there to stay. And one of the reasons we're seeing Generation Z operating quite differently on the streets in Yangon is because they are using social media.
The next question is from a Burmese student at GRIPS, also here in Tokyo, who one is saying that he and many of his friends believe that all Burmese need to regain their freedom soon. But his question is that most of the reforms, education reforms, and I'm expanding this to other reform processes, have also been strongly supported by international organizations and NGOs and international NGOs as well. So if this now the military situation continues, you know, what is your prospect for Myanmar? What will happen to these reforms?
So the government, which is the new government, which is being led by Min Aung Hlaing, is going to continue, wants to continue with the reform processes. Obviously, they can't get a start to that until the protests abate. Largely, it's impossible to, if you can't move goods around and if you can't get your ministries, your people to work in the ministries, then it's just becoming very, very difficult. What Min Aung Hlaing has done is he has appointed former ministers who were working under President Thein Sein and who were very effective at the reform processes. The difference here is that under President Thein Sein, the government came in with the goodwill of the nation and the goodwill of international development partners. It was a legal process. This is what has happened with the coup. It's clearly, from the international perspective, an illegal process. There's not going to be the same kind of goodwill. And domestically, well, I don't need to say anything, while there are people who will support the military dictatorship, the young people clearly don't, and large swaths of them don't. So I think the reform process can continue once the dust has settled, but it depends on how these protests are ended and how well or how quickly they're able to. If, for example, we have really a 1 year or 18 months roadmap, then I think the reforms can get picked up quite quickly again. But if the military entrenches itself, or if there's blood on the streets, then I think it's going to become more difficult.
I think we have time for two or three more questions. We have actually many. Thank you very much for participating. Kanji Yamamoto is asking how the private corporations are dealing with the current situation, electricity cuts, uprisings, closures, knockdowns in the evening and so forth. Do you have any updates from the ground?
Yeah, some of my colleagues and friends are in touch virtually on a daily basis whenever the internet's working, which is not at night, but it's during the day generally. And in fact, the reason that the internet can't be cut during the day is because of COVID, a lot has moved online, and Myanmar has become actually quite advanced in terms of being able to do transactions online. It's been quite amazing in how things have shifted. And if you cut the internet down during the daytime, businesses can't operate. And we saw that with the banks when people were queuing for the banks and then suddenly the ATMs ran out of money and the internet was down and no one could get any cash out, and that created further panic. Businesses are suffering. They were suffering under COVID. I mean, the restaurants are shut. People are not being allowed to meet and to go out. There have been very strict restrictions in urban areas, mainly Yangon, but other urban areas as well. So they were already suffering, and now the coup is making things a lot worse. And blocking the streets, obviously, is... But the aim of the young people, or the people in the streets, is exactly to lay everything still so that nothing can move, so that the government is returned. That's what they're hoping and expecting. That's not necessarily what's going to happen, but that's what they're hoping and expecting. And everyone is going to suffer as a result of that.
Next question is from Grace Tun at Smith College, and asking if interference from the international community is something worth waiting for.
First of all, interference from the international community, in my experience across South and Southeast Asia, has never helped anyone. The sanctions didn't do any harm, they did a lot of harm. They didn't do the kind of harm to the regime that the regime would have folded. Sanctions had nothing to do with the changeover that we had after 2010. This whole talk about sanctions or targeted sanctions is ultimately speaking something that the Western governments can do to make themselves feel better, but ultimately speaking, the only people who will suffer are the employees who work in businesses who are sanctioned. So in that sense, and what else would the international community do? We're not in a Rambo situation.
That is right. But Anna is asking the question if and how the Tatmadaw is reacting to international criticism. Isn't that also something that they cannot just ignore? You know, is there some silver lining?
No, I don't think they care. And I think if you understand the I tried to mention it at the beginning, the importance of the Tatmadaw in Myanmar politics. I mean, Myanmar generally, when you speak to people in Myanmar, and I've been doing this for almost 20 years now, they all say, oh, we are different from everyone. Actually, they are. I mean, Myanmar is a different country. The Tatmadaw is at the core of Myanmar politics. And they are, one of my Australian colleagues used the word, they are like a caste. They are in many ways the elite. They are a Burmah elite, Burmah being the majority ethnic group. They are battle hardened against ethnic groups in the region. I've written quite a lot on ethnic conflict and how that has affected education in ethnic regions. They don't care about the outside world. I think for them, what's important is that the country can function. There have been people who've been speculating about the role of China. China is very important as an investor, but the Tatmadaws had a reasonably good relationship with China. Then NLD had a reasonably good relationship with China. The one person who didn't have a reasonably good relationship with China was President Thein Sein between 2011 and 2015. As long as the country is operating within ASEAN and within East Asia, the Tatmadaw is not going to care about what the international community says.
Let's try with a different question. If you have a more positive outlook there, from Hido, I assume from Japan, what's your forecast considering Daw Aung San Suu Kyi's release? Is there any chance that you could be released from house arrest in 1 year from now? And second question from Hiro as well, does Tang Shui still keep influencing the politics in Myanmar?
So for the answer, a second one, my understanding is that Tan Shui, he is retired, he is around, but actually he has handed over to the current top brass. I'm not privy to any information whereby that he's pulling any strings, and people have conspiracy theories about these things. I do think that people who have, I mean, the current administration is in his image. So I don't think he would either, you know, I don't think he would have a problem with it, but I don't think he's pulling any strings. But again, you have to ask someone who studies the Tatmadaw in detail. Aung San Suu Kyi's release, well, I think we first have to wait and see. She's been charged with two counts of breaking the law. One was the Export-Import Act with the walkie-talkies that her bodyguards were using, and then also the breaking the COVID rules, the health rules basically around COVID in terms of the pre-election rallies that were going on. So each one of these carries a sentence of 3 years. I personally think that the aim of the current leadership is to break the NLD. And for that, they have to, they cannot have Aung San Suu Kyi out. The NLD without, it's because it's so centralized and because everything is around Aung San Suu Kyi, and she has not cultivated a younger generation of leaders to sort of move in, there's no succession strategy. In many ways, I think that if they manage to sideline her simply by having her again under house arrest, or by, I don't think they'll put her in jail, but by having her under house arrest a few years, that means that the next elections would likely be held without the NLD taking part, either the NLD withdrawing because they say it's not a fair process, or simply because they've been broken. I don't see a possibility, unless there were negotiations, which are not happening, I can't see a possibility of Aung San Suu Kyi being let go any earlier than what the minimum sentence is for at least one of these charges.
Well, I think this was not the most optimistic outlook maybe that many of us would have liked to hear.
I might be wrong. I might be wrong, and I'd be delighted to be wrong.
Yes, I think probably all of us hope so. And at the same time, we hope very much that the situation will not further escalate and solutions will be found, compromises will be sought. And I thank you all for your excellent questions, and especially to you, Marie. Thank you for joining you for the conversation series again. Thank you for giving us an excellent summary of the current situation and how complex the history of Myanmar is playing into the current options and current what's currently happening in Myanmar. Thank you all very much.
And thank you.
Please come and join us again for the next series. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.